I'm going to talk to you about an initiative we're really excited about that commenced in September 2016 called ICE-HBV, the International Coalition to Eliminate Hepatitis B. How do I move this forward? Okay, so in September 2016, a partnership between the ANRS in France, the Doherty Institute in Melbourne, but the real genesis of ICE-HBV was the International HBV meeting at Bad Nauheim, created ICE-HBV, which facilitated the establishment of subgroups in virology, immunology, innovative tools, and also clinical studies to define global HBV cure research priorities. And the genesis or the need for this came out of a realisation that our colleagues in the HIV sphere have been doing this for about 10 years, or since 2010, through the International AIDS Society. But there was really no initiative or organisation, if you like, that could do similar for HBV, or even for HCV, because we didn't have the equivalent of an International AIDS Society, certainly in HBV. So ICE-HBV is working with representatives from academia, so the basic and clinical sciences, also industry. We engage with industry through the HBV Forum, through Veronica Miller, and research agencies and also people affected with HBV. We've defined governance terms of reference and a mission statement, and we've established a secretariat since 2016. Sorry, I'm going the wrong way. So our aim is a safe, affordable, scalable and effective cure available to all persons living with chronic hepatitis B, and we acknowledge there are controversies, if you like, or still a lot of differences, if you like, with the definitions of HBV cure that Anna's so eloquently described that need to be resolved. But our vision is to be international, independent, research-based and a patient-centred forum with the emphasis strongly on international here. So we published a position paper in 2016 to highlight the need for ICE-HBV, and I just highlight this here, not to say how good we are, but to note here that the editors of Nature have said that this paper was one of the 180 must-read papers that could help change the world. Now, why this is so important is that the editors of Nature have recognised that curing hepatitis B is important. So I think that's fantastic. So our structure is we have a governing board, we have our scientific working groups in virology, immunology and innovative tools underpinned by clinical scientists. We have a senior advisors group, I'll go into some more details of these in a moment, and we have a stakeholders consulting group who also provide guidance as well. So our governing board, and most of us are here, if you've got any questions about ICE, please come and see us, we're almost all here. Our honorary president is Frank Cesari, I'm the chair at the moment and co-chaired with Fabian Zula from ANRS. And we're delighted that Joan Block is our most recent member of the governing board representing the Hepatitis B Foundation. And our ex officio, our secretariat is run by Capucine Penico, and Capucine came to us after 5 years experience running the HIV cure initiative in Europe. So we've developed our new governance systems, and membership of the governing board is going to be expanded very shortly to representatives from Asia and Africa and Latin America. And we're very conscious of gender balance as well. But it's extremely important that we engage with people from Asia and Africa, where the hepatitis B burden globally is most significant. So our senior strategic advisors, our chair of this committee is Frank Cesari, but our Ray Shanazi, Marion Peters and Christian Brousseau are all our senior advisors, and we're holding a meeting this week. I'm delighted that they're all here. It's fantastic. Thank you all for joining the initiative. And again, the membership of that committee or that group is going to be expanded to Asia and Africa in the coming years. So our working groups, our experts in virology are headed by Maura Dandry and Hightower Gao. Our immunology group is headed by Adam Gearing, who's here at this meeting, and Robert Thimay. Our innovative tools group is headed by Jiangming Hu and Fengming Liu. And our clinical studies group is headed by Harry Janssen, Pietro Lampiadico and Xingji Lim. And our activities. The first activity we're doing is we're putting together a scientific strategy, developing a position paper, if you like, on HBV cure for the field. We've also targeted specific international collaborative research projects, and I'll go into a little bit more detail on these, but particularly a cccDNA assay standardisation project. We've also initiated a mathematical modelling project on hepatitis B cure. And discussions are underway on new standardisation assays and initiatives that we can be involved with. The other thing we want to do is implement a science and policy strategy identifying health policy gaps, and also importantly to map cure funding. How are we going to increase funding for hepatitis B cure research? I learned recently that in the last 12 months that the total spend on HBV funding in the United States and the UK combined was $43 million, and for the same time period in HIV was $3 billion. So we're not saying that we want HIV to spend less, but I think we'd all agree that there needs to be more spent in hepatitis B research. And we also want to promote that research to, and collaboration to try and increase the focus on cure. So what we're doing at the moment is producing a joint position paper. Those working groups on immunology and virology and innovative tools have brainstormed extensively over the last 12 months and prioritised the main areas for hepatitis B research for immune control and cure, or functional cure and complete cure. And just to briefly go through some of the priorities that have been identified from virology priorities, and these are not in order, but these are the five priorities that the virology group has come up with, is to define the mechanisms determining HBV infection establishment from cell entry to cccDNA mini-chromosome formation, its chromatization and metabolism. And importantly, to develop standardised methods to study the mechanisms of cccDNA mini-chromosome homeostasis and the processes affecting its stability and activity, to understand the relevance and control of the circulating RNA markers that we heard about earlier. Do they really represent cccDNA transcription? Understand the role of DNA integration in carcinogenesis and in surface antigen production, and improve methodologies for the study of cccDNA metabolism and virus-host interactions. And from an immunology perspective, it's critical to have new methods for ex vivo analysis of HBV-specific immunity in the peripheral blood and the liver to better correlate HBV immunity with the stage of disease and response to antiviral therapy. Determine the relative contribution of the different mechanisms to T-cell exhaustion, the extent to which HBV-specific immunity can be safely restored, and how much restoration is actually required for hepatitis B cure. We've done very little work on B cells in our field. It's really important that the focus is increased on B cells and the mechanisms by which HBV either escapes or in fact subverts innate immune responses. We need to understand better the number of hepatocytes that are actually infected. I mean, what's the contribution of cytolytic and non-cytolytic clearance of HBV-infected cells induced by immune responses and immunotherapies in the liver? And then again, standardisation. We need to standardise immune monitoring in clinical trials that needs to be tailored to the new drug's modes of action with appropriate timing and intrahepatic sampling. And then in terms of the research priorities, in terms of the tools, and we're going to hear some great talks on these, particularly from the in vivo systems, I know from Helene shortly on the immunocompetent mouse models, but we need better systems for in vitro and from in vivo monitoring of hepatitis B. We can now infect in cell culture, but everyone would realise that this is still incredibly difficult. We need new models. So we need to develop immunopluripotent stem cells. We need to look at organoids. We need to develop an immunocompetent mouse model that's susceptible to infection, that's routinely accessible and easy to use. We need to perhaps revisit the Tapia model. We need to look at NTCP, human transformed NTCP in macaques. We need to develop new research assays. We need to look at the omics approaches that are being used in a whole lot of other fields, kinomics, metabolomics, proteomics. We need to develop convenient and reliable markers to detect that cccDNA mini-chromosome, knowing that we won't have access to the liver. And we need, as Anna said, we need new point-of-care diagnostic tools for hepatitis B, particularly in low- and middle-income countries. I think there's 70 different serum surface antigen point-of-care assays out there, and none of them are any good as far as I know. So we need something that'll work well. And we need to develop new methodologies to study cccDNA mini-chromosome. And we need to harmonise these approaches so that results that we see from one country we know apply to other countries. So to touch on that, there has been a wonderful harmonisation project in cccDNA standardisation that was run by the University of Hamburg, the DZIF and the ANRS. And ICE-HBV has got involved in this project and expanded it globally, so we now have representatives from all over the world, from Asia, from Australia, from the United States. And this results were presented by Lena Olwis. Work in progress was presented by Lena at the International HBV meeting most recently. So this is a great example of how ICE-HBV can bring people together and help with these sorts of standardisation projects. So we think there might be a need for new standardisation projects, and we haven't really discussed this any further than a brief discussion at the board level, but it may well be that we need standardisation and globalised looks at the serum RNA, the relevance of serum RNA, core-related antigen. Should we do comparisons of the new cell culture models, the iPSCs and the organoids? There's probably a real need for standardised peptide libraries, such as they have for the HIV field at NIH. Perhaps ICE-HBV could help organise those. And I've just elaborated on the need, or touched on the need, for the point-of-care diagnostics. We have a number of consultations with stakeholders. We had at the HBV Forum, we were at the World Hepatitis Summit, we had a stakeholders meeting in Sao Paulo very recently, and also in Australia, and we're having a senior advisors meeting here. And we're publishing our four-year scientific strategy in early 2018. So we want to engage with you. We're on Twitter, we're on website, we're all here, so please come and talk to us if you've got anything you'd like to know about with ICE-HBV, we'd love to hear from you, we'd love to work with you, because it's going to be, everybody's going to have to be involved to cure this damn thing. I'd like to thank all of these people for their involvement directly in ICE-HBV, and a little bit of a plug in my last 10 seconds. The International HBV meeting is going to be in Australia in 2 years' time, so if you're working on hepatitis B, if you're all interested in hepatitis B, come and join myself and Wenwei Lee when we host this meeting in Australia. But thank you all for your attention, and I welcome any questions.